to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
The Apostle Peter said, "Can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized?" Then he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Acts chapter 10, verses 47 and 48. We welcome you today to our study of cases of conversion in the book of Acts. As we think today about this powerful case of the conversion of Cornelius, we encourage you to stay tuned as we open our hearts and our minds to the Word and the will of Almighty God. Cornelius is a very interesting man as we look at his conversion. The Bible tells us that he's a soldier. He is a centurion. Notice Acts chapter 10, beginning in verse number 1. The Scripture records of Cornelius, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment. This is a man who is an authority. This is a man who's over people. He was a soldier, people not necessarily known at that time for their religious tendencies, but not only was he a soldier, he was a very high-ranking soldier. A centurion was a captain over at least 100 other soldiers. They were what is called the backbone of the Roman army. And his regiment came out of Italy, and so a very important man. But you know, as we think about this man, he's important, he understands authority, no doubt he's a hard worker, but he's also a God-fearer. Look at 1 Corinthians or Acts chapter 10, verse number 2. The Scripture records of Cornelius that he was a devout man, one who feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people, and prayed to God always. Was this man a Gentile or a proselyte? The following evidence helps us to see that this man was a Gentile. The fact that at his conversion, circumcision, the astonishment about some circumcision is there in Acts chapter 10. That the people of the circumcision tried to get upset about this also suggests these ideas, and that in Jerusalem there was a whole discussion in Acts chapter 15 relative to these ideas. But you know, more important than that, when we think about Cornelius, who is going to need to obey the gospel, let's realize Cornelius is a religious man. A devout man. The Bible says he is devout, meaning that he was reverent, he was religious, he was one who regularly engaged in worship and service to God. That's the idea behind devout. One who feared God, literally a God-fearer, suggests that he may have been a Gentile whose life was devoted to serving God under the patriarchal law. But we also know something else about Cornelius. He was a generous man. He gave alms regularly. He was willing to help those who were in need. And so, a devout man, one who feared God, one who was willing to give, and one who put his trust in the Almighty in every way. And yet, this man is still going to need to submit to Christ. You know, as we learn about Cornelius, he also prayed continually. He prayed often. Pray without ceasing, the Scripture says. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17. Morning, evening, and noon, I'll cry unto thee, the psalmist said. He tried to do the right thing. Acts chapter 10, verse 22 tells us this was a man who had a good reputation among the whole Jewish nation as a soldier and a religious man. Integrity was a part of his life. My friend, listen carefully. To a man of authority, to a man who was devout, who feared God, who prayed, who gave alms, who was known as a good man, Cornelius still needed the gospel. Listen carefully. I've heard people say, I don't need God and I don't need Christianity because I'm a good person. Being a good person is not going to save you. If anybody ever would have been saved by being good, it might have been Cornelius. He did a lot of good things. He was a devout person. He was committed to helping the poor. He was a regular worshiper of God. But Cornelius still had to hear the gospel. Although he was a good, moral, religious person, That's not what saves. He was lost and he still needed to be saved. Verse 6 tells us there is something he must do. He had to have something to do to be right with God, and Acts 11 verse 14 tells us what that was. Cornelius had to hear words whereby he could be saved. Friend, if people are going to be saved, as we have reiterated in every lesson, to be saved, one must hear the Word of Almighty God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Acts to Romans chapter 10, verse number 17. And then, of course, as you continue to read in Acts chapter 10, we now see this vision that comes to Cornelius. God is now going to send salvation to his way. Look in Acts chapter 10, beginning in verse number 3. The Scripture says, about the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God coming in and saying to him, Cornelius. And when he observed him, he was afraid and said, What is it, Lord? So he said to him, Your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa and send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging with Simon a tanner, whose house is by the sea. He will tell you what you must do. And when the angel who spoke to him had departed, Cornelius called two of his household servants and a devout soldier from among those who waited on him continually. So when he explained all these things to them, he sent them to Joppa. Here God speaks to Cornelius, as he had done to the heads of the houses throughout the patriarchal law. God had heard Cornelius' prayer. Cornelius now is told, there's a man coming to tell you what you must do. Acts chapter 10, verse number 6, and when he comes, Cornelius is going to listen intently to that message. Now, along with speaking to Cornelius, God now sends a vision to Peter. Peter is praying. He's up on the rooftop, if you remember. And he falls into a trance or a vision, and there is this image. Peter's ready to eat, but the meal's not quite ready yet, and so he's hungry. And in a vision, there's this spread of all kinds of heavenly food, clean and unclean. Animals appear before Peter. And Peter is told, rise, kill and eat. Peter thinks about it and he realizes, after he's been sent to Cornelius, what God's called clean, don't call unclean. In essence, Peter learns, all men everywhere need to hear the gospel, regardless of race, regardless of background, regardless of how well or we like or don't like them. That's not the importance. All men everywhere need the gospel. In fact, God wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. 1 Timothy 2 and verse number 4. That's what he wanted for Cornelius, and that's what he wants for men and women today as well. You see, the Bible says, the Lord's not slow concerning His promises, as some men count slowness, but He's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so, just as God told Peter to go to Cornelius, Peter does make his way that way. And I want you to notice what happens when Peter and Cornelius meet in Acts chapter 10. Look in verse number 24. Acts 10 verse 24 says, and the following day, he entered Caesarea, that's Peter. Now Cornelius was waiting for them, and he called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him, fell down in his feet and worshiped him, but Peter lifted him up saying, stand up, I myself am also a man. Here's a man who's ready to hear the gospel. You know, we talk about hearing the gospel, and this man was ready. He's waiting, and not only is he waiting, God spoke to him, and he's got his friends and relatives there. He wants everybody to be saved too. And so he's waiting with his family and friends. When they meet, Cornelius is so amazed and so thankful, we might say, that Peter is willing to come and speak to him, that he does something unusual. He falls down at Peter's feet as though to worship him. Did Peter accept that? Peter said, stand up. I myself am also a man. Friend, listen carefully, and I hope you'll understand the practical application that we're making here. Men and proclaimers of the gospel and servants of Christ, we're just men. We're just human beings. We all stand on level ground at the foot of the cross. We've all had to deal with the sting of sin, and nobody is any better than anyone else. Christ is our Lord. We serve Him, and we've got to realize we all stand on level ground at the foot of the cross. Now, let's make practical applications. Sometimes people will try to say, and there's a whole ideology of doctrine based on it, that Peter was the first pope. Now, I want you to think about this. Here's what happens when Cornelius falls down before Peter. He's so amazed. Peter would come to him that as a sign of thankfulness, he falls down to worship him. What'd Peter do? Peter say, "You like my funny hat? Want to kiss my ring too?" No, it's not what Peter said. What'd Peter do? "Stand up. I'm just a man. We're on the same level ground. There's no big me and little you or little me and big you. We all stand on level ground." Peter realized he wasn't deserving of worship. Now, friend, listen real carefully. In the Bible, we don't find worshiping men as part of God's plan. We don't find the worship of angels as part of God's plan. Revelation chapter 19, John fell down before the angel, and the angel said the same thing, "Stand up. Don't worship me. We're just deliverers of the testimony of Christ." And so, we're not going to fall down before men and worship them. If Peter wouldn't accept it, how dare men do it today? If angels wouldn't accept it then, how dare we try to do that today? And so we've got to put the focus where it needs to be on Almighty God. Now, I want you to continue with me as we think about the message that Peter gives Cornelius here. Continue noticing in Acts chapter 10, verse number 27. "As he talked with him," that's Peter and Cornelius, "he went in and found many who had come together. Scripture records, then he said to them, 'You know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company with or go to one of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore I came without objection as soon as I was sent. For I asked then, for what reason have you sent me?'" Cornelius goes on to tell him, "I received this vision. God told me you were going to come and preach the gospel, and I was going to learn what I must do to be right with God." Now here's that message. Acts chapter 10, look in verse number 34. The Scripture records, "Then Peter opened his mouth and said, 'In truth I perceive God shows no partiality, but in every nation he who fears Him and works righteousness is accepted by Him.'" We learn from verses 34 and 35, as we think about God and salvation, that God's not prejudiced. Isn't it wonderful? God doesn't look at the color of my skin. God doesn't look at the color of my eyes or the color of my hair or how much of an education or how much money or gender or things related to that. Men often are so biased and prejudiced based on the superficial, tangible things. Not God. God's not concerned with that. Every nation that fears Him and works righteousness, those are the ones who can be saved. That's why the Scripture says God wants all men to be saved. God wants people in China. God wants people in Europe. God wants people in Africa. God wants people in every part of the world to be saved. Remember again 2 Peter 3:9. God's not slow concerning His promises as some men count slowness. Listen to this though. "But He's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." Then in verses 34 through 41, Peter is now going to preach the message of Christ, His death, His burial, and His resurrection to Cornelius. Notice beginning in verse number 34, the Scripture again says, "In truth I perceive God shows no partiality, but in every nation, whoever fears Him and works righteousness is accepted by Him. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, He is Lord of all. That word you know, which is proclaimed throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all these things, of all things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree. Him God raised up on the third day and showed openly, not to all the people, but to witnesses chosen before by God, even to us who ate and drank with Him after He arose from the dead." What is it that Peter specifically tells Cornelius about it. He says, I want to tell you about Jesus. And you've heard it, you know it. God did miracles and signs and wonders, just like in Acts 2, where Peter said God has approved Jesus through these miracles. He reminds these people, you've heard about the miracles. Is there any doubt? They had heard about the demoniac, who the legion of demons had been cast out of, who those demons went into the herd of swine and the swine ran violently off the cliff. Is there any doubt that they had heard about the raising of Lazarus or the feeding of the 5,000 or many of the great miracles Jesus did? No doubt they had heard those. They knew of these things. And Peter says, you know about these things. And he says, this Jesus who I'm telling you about, they killed him. Yes, he was put to death, but Jesus was raised by the power of God. And He lives and is at the right hand of the Almighty right now. Jesus' death, His burial, and His resurrection was preached to Cornelius. And friend, that's the heart. That's the heart of the gospel. When we talk to men about obeying the gospel, when we talk about hearing the Word of God, you've got to hear that Jesus is God's Son, that He is the only way of salvation. We've got to understand that God sent Him to be a sacrifice for our sins. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that part of God's plan was His Son, His own Son, would die on the cross. For without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. Hebrews 9:22. But you've got to hear this message as well. Don't let it stop there. That same Jesus whom they killed, He's not dead right now. Yeah, He was buried. He was raised, and He's at the right hand of God. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ, and Him being the risen Savior, is a key part of Peter's message. And friend, if we believe that, we're well on the way to knowing what God wants us to do to be saved. But there's one other thing Peter mentions, and I want you to notice in Acts chapter 10, verse number 42. Peter then says this, and He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that it is He who was ordained by God to be judge of the living and the dead. Peter preaches judgment day, that Christ is the judge of the living and the dead, that this Jesus whom I'm telling you about, one day we're going to stand before Him and He's going to judge all the living and all the dead. 2 Corinthians 10 verses 3 through 5 says that we must each present ourselves before Christ, that we may receive an account for the things done in the body, whether good or evil. So then each of us shall give an account of himself to God. Romans 10 verse 12. Friend, listen carefully. Not only do I need to know about the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, I need to know I must obey Christ, because on that final day, the judgment day, He'll be the judge. He'll be the one making the decisions, and it'll be His Word that judges us. John chapter 12, verse number 48. Now, I want you to notice then what Peter says about how these people can receive forgiveness for their sins. Look in Acts chapter 10 and notice verse number 43. To Him all the prophets witness that through His name whoever believes in Him will receive remission of sin. Peter preached, you've got to believe in Jesus, and that as part of obedience to the gospel, one could be forgiven of sins. And so there's this forgiveness of sins that's offered. And then next in verses 44 through 46, as a second sign of God opening the doors of the kingdom to the Gentiles, the Holy Spirit falls on Cornelius and his household. Now, if you remember, that first happened in Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit fell on Peter and the rest of the apostles, and they began to speak with unknown tongues and unknown languages, and it was a sign of God opening the door of salvation to the Jews. Cornelius, now a Gentile convert, God's Holy Spirit falls on them as a sign that the gospel has now been opened for the Gentiles. And I want you to notice what Peter says in Acts chapter 10 in response to that Holy Spirit falling on them as a sign of them receiving, ready to receive God's salvation. Look at what is said in verses 47 and 48. The Bible records, then Peter answered, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who received the Holy Spirit, now watch this, just as we have, just like on the day of Pentecost. And He commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then they asked Him to stay a few days. Friend, I want you to just stop and think about the things that are said here. Cornelius has to hear about Christ. And friend, to be saved, that's what men and women today must do. If faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, Romans 10:17, and if without faith it's impossible to please God, then we can naturally conclude, I've got to hear God's Word to have faith, which is essential to being saved. Once I've heard that message, I've got to believe. Cornelius and his household, they had to believe that Jesus was God's Son, that He was the one who was prophesied of in Scripture, that He's the one who made that great sacrifice, that it's through His death, burial, and resurrection they can be saved, and that ultimately He's going to be the judge on that last day. You remember Jesus' words in John chapter 8, verse number 24? Jesus said, unless you believe that I'm He, you'll surely die in your sins. I've got to believe Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man comes to the Father except by Him. In view of the judgment, there's no doubt these people realized they had to also repent of those sins which were separating them from God. You know, when we think about repentance, sometimes people want to make an outward expression that which repentance is, but that's not what repentance is. In Luke chapter 3, verse number 8, certain Jews came out to be baptized by John, and the context indicates that they were doing that just because that's what everybody else was doing. You know what John said to them? Those who want to be baptized just to be like everybody else, John said, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? And then he said this, bring forth fruits worthy of repentance. Friend, real fruit or real repentance has fruit. Fruit is that which is an identifiable product of one's life that is connected to the true vine, Jesus Christ. And thus, our life must bear fruit to God, changed way of life, changed way of thinking that leads to a changed way of living. No doubt these people as well recognize Jesus as the Son of God, and they're willing to acknowledge their faith in Him. And for men and women to be saved today, they must recognize that Jesus not only is the Son of God, they must be willing to confess that as that He is their Savior. Again, Romans 10 verse 10, with the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And just as we saw in Acts chapter 8, as the Ethiopian eunuch is traveling down the road in the chariot with Philip, he sees water in the distance. He wants to know, how do I get into Christ? Here's water. What doth hinder me? If you believe with all your heart, you may. And he said this, I believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And friend, I want you to listen again to Acts chapter 10. Verse 47 and 48, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized? Listen to this now. Then He commanded them to be baptized. To be right with God, the Scriptures teach one must be baptized. Let me remind you again of the cases that we've seen thus far. In the book of Acts, as it related to conversion and the place of baptism in that, the 3,000 on Pentecost, when they realized they'd killed their Savior and they wanted to be right with God, what did God say? Repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. Acts 2, verse number 38. When Saul of Tarsus responded to the Lord by saying, Lord, what would you have me to do? Acts 9, verse 6. He was told, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Baptism was for the remission of sins, Acts 2, verse 38. Baptism was to have their sins washed away, Acts 20, or have his sins washed away, Acts 22, verse 16. And if you remember from the account of the Ethiopian eunuch, when he obeys the gospel, he went on his way rejoicing. Baptism is how you find true joy, being in Christ. Salvation is in Christ, 2 Timothy 1, verse 10. We're baptized into Christ, Galatians chapter 3, verse 27, therefore, I can't be in Christ and have the joy of Christ, as these folks did in Acts chapter 10, until I obey the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Friend, as we have thought about these conversions in the book of Acts, We're pleading with you today. We encourage you. Think about your own salvation. This is the most important matter in all the world. More important than anything else you can think of. Your soul is your most valuable asset. Jesus said, "What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul?" Today we're asking you, think about your soul's salvation. Have you really obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ? Have you done what they did in the book of Acts to become Christians? Have you submitted to God's will, and are you sure that you're right with the Almighty? Friend, if you've never obeyed the gospel, we encourage you today, become a Christian. Become just simply a New Testament Christian and submit to the will of Christ. If someone told you to do something other than maybe what you've read about today, friend, it's never too late to do what the Bible says. As long as we have the opportunity, let's have the heart and the mind that I'm going to submit to God, I'm going to obey the gospel, I'm going to do whatever it takes to go to heaven. May God help us to do just that. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the gospel of Christ.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905 or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee 37111.
This is the gospel of Christ.